Hey guys! In my terrain rendering series, there is a tutorial on implementing a skybox in OpenGL. As you can see here, a skybox is simply a 3D texture which wraps the viewer in every direction. To implement it, we load 6 separate images into the 6 faces of a cube map texture, and we use a 3D vector to sample from the cube map. Well, for more details, make sure to check out that video. The problem with cube map textures is that they are not so easy to find as separate images. More often than not, you will find these panoramic images in a 2D format. If you look closely, you will notice that they provide a 360 degree view. However, we still need to find a way to map this 2D image to the 6 faces of the cube map, which is exactly what we're going to do today. Now, to understand this process, you will need some knowledge about trigonometry, which is a good opportunity for me to introduce today's sponsor, which is Brilliant. On brilliant.org, you will find everything you need to level up your trigonometry skills. You will do this with the help of interactive lessons that support your learning experience and are also fun to interact with. In addition to trigonometry, you will also find lots of material on data analysis, programming, and AI. All the content on Brilliant was created by a top-notch team of teachers and researchers from places like MIT, as well as companies which you may have heard of, such as Google and Microsoft. This approach has proven itself to be much more effective compared to, you know, just passively watching another YouTube video. What's also great about Brilliant is that you can try everything for free for a full 30 days. Just visit brilliant.org/ogldev or click the link in the video description. You will get a 20% off an annual premium subscription, and thank you Brilliant for sponsoring this video. Okay, going back to cube mapping, it seems that what we need to do is go over the panoramic image one pixel after the other, row by row, and somehow map it to the corresponding pixel on one of the cube map faces. But people claim that doing that will result in various distortions on the cube map. Therefore, we will actually do this the other way around. Go over the 6 faces of the destination cube map, pixel by pixel, and map it to the panoramic image. By the way, the formal name of such an image is an equirectangular image, and the process that creates it is called an equirectangular projection. The classic example is the map of the world, which is an equirectangular projection of the surface of the Earth. To begin the process, we use the STB library function stbiloadf to load the source image as floating points. We initialize an instance of the bitmap class using the dimensions of the image and the data which we just loaded. I copied this class from the 3D graphics rendering cookbook, and the algorithm is based on one of its chapters. I was able to significantly simplify the process, which is why you should definitely watch this video until the very end. If you're interested, you can find an Amazon affiliate link to the book in the video description and on my website. The bitmap class is very simple. It stores the data in a vector of bytes and provides a simple interface to access individual pixels based on the number of components in a pixel and the internal data type. In addition to the source image, we also prepare a vector of bitmaps for the result. Most of the heavy lifting is done in the function convertEquirectangularImage to cubemap. It takes the source bitmap as input and places the result in the vector of bitmaps. We begin by calculating the size of the cubemap face. This face is of course a square, so the width equals the height. Now imagine taking the image as a piece of paper and wrapping it perfectly around the cube. There should be no remainder in this process, which means the size of the cube face is 1/4 the width of the image. Next, we resize the vector of the result for 6 faces and initialize each face with the same width and height. The number of components and their type comes from the source image. Now comes the core part of this function. We loop over the 6 faces of the cube map, then the height of the face, and finally the width. We are going to map the current pixel to spherical coordinates, but before we do that, we have to calculate the pixel position in Cartesian coordinates. However, this is not going to be your standard left or right-handed coordinate system. This is because the standard description of spherical coordinates, which I'm going to explain in a minute, references an entirely different system of Cartesian coordinates. So, brace yourself. In this system, the x-axis is aligned with the z-axis of the right-handed coordinate system, the y-axis points to the right, and the z-axis points up. For some reason, this convention is preferred in physics, and we will keep it that way because most of the resources you will find work like that. The function which maps the current pixel to this physics coordinate system takes the generic triplet x, y and face index from the loop, as well as the face size. It starts by normalizing x and y to the range of 0 and 2. Next, it checks the face index, and at this point, we have to talk about how OpenGL manages the cube map because it adds another layer of complexity to this mess. The thing is that OpenGL expects the cube map to be in a left-handed coordinate system. Okay, so x goes to the right, y goes up, and z goes forward. In the initial implementation of the Skybox, we used the non-direct state access, or DSA, function glTextImage2D to load the data using the macros that OpenGL defines to identify each face. But today, we're going to use the DSA version of the API. This means calling glCreateTextures instead of glBindTexture to create the cube map. The first parameter is the same in both cases, but in the DSA version, we use glTextureStorage2D to allocate the memory for all the faces, and glTextureSubImage3D to load the data for each face. The target face is identified by the zOffset parameter, and as you can see, we have to use a zero-based index here instead of the original macro. Therefore, I created a set of macro definitions for these indices, which correspond to the OpenGL macros. The switch case statement checks the OpenGL face index and maps it to a coordinate in the physics coordinate system. For example, positive x in OpenGL is mapped to 1 on the y-axis because in the physics system the y goes to the right. Negative x goes the other way, so it is mapped to minus 1 on the y-axis. Positive y is mapped to 1 on the z-axis because z goes up, and negative y is mapped to minus 1 because, again, positive z goes up. So in general, in each case, one of the components of the result is either 1 or minus 1, because the faces of the cube are parallel to the planes of the coordinate system. Now what about the other two components of the result? We will use them to calculate the UV coordinates of the face texture, and OpenGL is very specific about their direction. For example, in the case of positive z, the u goes along positive x and v along negative y. So we have minus 1 in the x component, again, because this is the physics coordinate system, and we use the incoming x, which is mapped to minus 1 to 1 in the form of a, for the y component, which is mapped to positive x. The reason that v goes along the negative y is because OpenGL uses a bottom left coordinate system for all textures, so v must be flipped. This is why we have 1 minus b instead of b minus 1 as in the a case. So v goes from 1 to minus 1. In the case of negative z, we flip the direction of x, which is z in OpenGL. Y, which is x, is also flipped because now we are going from right to left instead of left to right as in positive z. And finally z, which is y, remains the same as in positive z. I realize that this is a major headache, so you probably need some time offline to let it sink in, but let's try to continue. The result of this function is a 3D coordinate in the physics coordinate system, where one of the components is either 1 or minus 1 to point to one of the faces, and the other two components go from minus 1 to 1 or the other way around to match the expectation of OpenGL. The next step is to calculate the spherical coordinate of the current point. A spherical coordinate system is yet another method of specifying the location of a point in 3D space. Instead of offsets along the three major axes, we have a distance from the origin, usually denoted by the Greek letter rho, and two angles. The azimuthal angle phi, which goes between the x and y axes, and the polar angle theta, which goes between z and the xy plane. Notice that when phi is zero, the direction is along positive x, and the range of phi is between 0 and 360 degrees, or 2 pi radians. When theta is 0, the direction is along positive z, and the range of theta is only 0 and 180, or 1 pi radian, because we can only go between positive and negative z. Theta simply doesn't go the full circle. I won't do the entire derivation of the spherical coordinates equations, because it will take too much time and there are many good videos that focus on that. What we need to calculate here is just the angles phi and theta. As you can see in this Wikipedia page, this requires calculating the arctangent of these two fractions, but there are multiple cases depending on the direction of the axes. Therefore, it is recommended to use the atan2 function, which takes into account the quadrant of the input. So this is what we do in the implementation. One peculiarity I should point out is that the order of parameters in the theta case is actually reversed. Using the documented order results in a nasty distortion. I don't have much time to debug this right now, so if you have any idea what's going on, please comment. Next, we need to calculate the 2D textural coordinates that correspond to the Cartesian coordinates on the cube map. This will allow us to sample the color from the source image. This is where the spherical coordinates comes in handy. Imagine placing a sphere inside the cube so that the center of both objects is the same. We can shoot rays from the center, which will go through the surface of the sphere and hit the cube at some point. This point is the current pixel in the loop, and it is known to us by its Cartesian and spherical coordinates. The corresponding point on the sphere is actually a projection of the outer point on the cube map along that ray. So both points share the same phi and theta. We can map phi to the u-axis so that going from 0 to 360 degrees will go from 0 to 1 in texture space. We can map theta to the v-axis so that going from the top apex to the bottom apex will go from 0 to 1 in texture space. Both angles were calculated using the atan2 function, whose results go from minus pi to plus pi. This is of course in radians. In the case of phi, we get the full range, and in the case of theta, we get half the range, so minus half of pi to plus half of pi. Mapping it to a textural coordinate is very simple. In the case of phi, we add pi and divide the result by 2 times pi. So when phi equals to minus pi, we get 0, and when it is equal to plus pi, we get 1. Theta is a bit trickier. Because of OpenGL handling of the v-axis, we need to flip the direction, so when theta equals to half of pi, we get 0, and when it equals to minus half of pi, we get 1. We can now scale up the textural coordinates by the corresponding dimensions of the image and get the pixel coordinates to be used for sampling the color. Based on our location in the loop, we use the indices face, x and y, to set the color value in the corresponding face of the cube map. We can now go ahead and create the texture object using GL create textures and GL texture cube map as the parameter. We set the various texture parameters and allocate the entire space using GL texture storage 2D and the width and height of a single face. This function call will allocate all the 6 faces, so now we need to loop over them, extract the pointer to the data of each face, and call GL texture subimage 3D to set the data for this face. Notice the usage of Z offset as the layer number. The layers are zero-based and correspond to the macros which we have used earlier. So this is the result, and if you look closely, it's not the best looking image. We can actually improve this using bilinear sampling. We sample 4 pixels from the source image around the original location by rounding down the texture coordinates and then adding 1. The fractional part is used to interpolate the final color. And that's it for today. Remember that you can get a 20% off an annual premium subscription to Brilliant. Thank you for watching, and thanks again Brilliant for sponsoring this video.